This week has been, I think you would agree with me, have been a very horrific week. Things that have transpired and things that are still happening. You have the shooting in California, and that's just a gut check when you think about things. And also you think about the wildfires that are happening as well. And, you know, our hearts go out to those victims and those who have been displaced. And certainly we have a soft spot, and we're concerned about those victims and their families. But so what we'll do, I want to pray for those situations before we even get started today, and ask the Lord to bless and to help out as only He can. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to You today, and we do so because we have access that's been granted by the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, this morning, as we have just made mention briefly about some things that are happening in our world is hurting. Our world is searching. Lord, I know that as I look, I believe our world is hungry for that which only satisfies, and they need help. Lord, I pray You'd help each one of us as Your children, Your followers, that You would help us to shine the light, that as we live our lives, it would cause others to see the Savior that we have found and the difference He makes. Lord, we pray for those are in the pathway of those fires. I pray that as they're raging, that at this moment they would be extinguished. Lord, I pray for those that have been a victim of this senseless shooting in California. I pray, Lord, that You would somehow use these tragedies to bring and to expand Your kingdom. Lord, we thank You for this time that we get to gather together and to pray. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to take up a love offering for Sunrise Children's Homes, and that's a great thing that you'll get to hear more about. And so as we think about that, I want you to watch this video just for a minute, give you an idea of what they do.
She's going through all these questions. What kind of family do you want? Do you want brothers? Do you want sisters? Do you just want brothers? Or what mix do you want? What religion do you prefer? Is it okay if I can't get you in the same school but get you around the same area? I didn't know any foster family that had taken a 17-year-old kid. It was too much of a struggle. They're not going to find anybody to take me in. It all started when I was around 9 years old. I had a mom that was hooked on drugs and just hooked on a lifestyle. I wasn't a normal kid at 9. I was pretty angry, pretty frustrated. It's kind of rough being a young kid and coming in and have your mom all strung out, you know, and not knowing what to do. I went and lived with my grandparents. They were like my lifesavers. It was me and my sister that grew up in the house together. My sister, she had cystic fibrosis. If you ever know anything, you get that feeling like something's wrong with something when some stuff usually don't happen. Like, I never got taken out of school. So when they call me down to the office, I go, what's going on? I'm in the car with my grandma, and I'm praying. I'm like, God, please don't take my sister away from me. I got home and I look at my grandpa and I say, how's Liz doing? He goes, sorry to tell you, but she ain't no longer with us. It was hard, you know, me being 13 years old. That was the first meeting with death that I had. A few years down the road, I'm 16 and everything's doing good. I have the counseling going. I have all the other stuff going, the grief counseling, the anger management. And I got home because my grandma was usually home by 3 or 3:30 every day, and I knew something was wrong because she wasn't home. And I finally called the hospital, and they say, you know, Mr. Shaw, you need to get down here quick. So I'm praying again in the car with my grandpa, praying, Lord, just don't take my mom away from me. I mean, that's what I knew my grandparents as. My grandpa was dad, my grandma was mom. They take me and my grandpa into this room. He said, Mr. Shaw, I'm sorry to tell you, but your wife's gone. You know, I didn't know how to deal with it. A 16-year-old kid, I couldn't take care of a 60-year-old man by myself. So I'm on the phone, I got a case manager. So I'm trusting her, she's going through all these questions with me. She's going through, you know, what's your idea of a family? Where do you want to live at? Do you want to stay at home? Do you want to go to a different school? Or is it okay if I can't get you in the same school, but get you around the same area where you can still go down and see grandpa and, you know, still have that relationship with your grandpa that you needed? I didn't know any foster family that had taken a 17-year-old kid. And for me, I mean, my rap sheet was a mile long of the problems I had. I'm thinking, you know, this ain't going to be good. They're not going to do, you know, they're not going to find anybody to take me in. Well, here comes Jerry and Jenny. Best two people I've ever met in my life that are foster parents with. Sunrise step into my life. Throughout the counseling process with Sunrise, you know, their therapists, their case managers, and just the whole support system. I figured I did not only just have my foster parents I could lean on, but I had the workers at Sunrise also. I've had a lot given to me, and I feel like I should give back a lot more. I'm in school for nursing, trying to do something positive with my life, and not being what the world plans me out to be. And not following the direction of my mom and the path she went down. It was just, it's just the way that, you know, God blesses you when you shouldn't be blessed. Everybody's always helped me and gave me that support system, and always, you know, I've always had people when I needed them. I just want to be that blessing to other people. My name is Aaron Green. I'm 21. I have hope. I have a family. I'm studying to be a nurse, all because Sunrise found me.
Amen. That's the offering we're going to be taking up tonight during our Thanksgiving meal. So be thinking about that and how you want to contribute. And they're on their website, there are, I didn't count exactly, but there are numerous videos just like that, different ages, different places where they have helped children, young men and women, find purpose and find Jesus. Amen? All right. Also, tonight I've been asked to announce that if you would like to assist in any way taking the meals to those who are unable to be here tonight with us to eat, to please meet with Miss Libby right down here on this side before after the service is over. And also, I've also been asked to announce on this side of the after it's over, we have a very brief trustees meeting. So both meetings at same place, at different places at the same time. But also, we are in desperate need of some nursery workers. And I see a whole room full of them. And I'm being serious. We have needs. And I know God is calling many of you all to help out, and now it's time. And not this specific moment, but there'll be, if you'd like to be involved, see myself or Miss Heather or Miss Amy, somebody, because we need help in the nursery area. But also, tonight, before we have our Thanksgiving meal, we're going to have a building update, some things I know you'll want to hear. But today, as we go forward in our service, I want to thank those who have served in our armed forces. We appreciate you very much. And I look at you, those who have served and are serving, as heroes. And I got a little video I want you all to watch, and then we'll go a little further. So.
The 11th hour does not strike on the clock of every man. For at this time, most of us can be found at home, comfortable, knowing tomorrow is right on its way. At the 11th hour, most of us can be found in our beds. But in another world, our men and our women, our brothers and our sisters live in this hour. Tick, tick, tick. Every second for you, every second for me. So it was on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918. The guns were lowered. The trenches grew silent. And an armistice was declared between the Allied nations and Germany. A great war hushed so that the wives, the children, the fathers and the mothers could salute back across the ocean. And it is on this day each year that we have stopped to salute our veterans, our men and women of the 11th hour. So today, it's our turn. It's our turn to show our gratitude. It's our turn to applaud when they stand. It's our turn to thank God for you. Yes, it's our turn to say thank you for going in our stead.
At this moment, I'd like, if you have served in our armed services, I'm going to ask you to please stand just for a brief moment. If you have served, please stand. Amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for each one of these individuals and their families that have stood. We are so grateful that they answered the call. Lord, I pray that you bless them and their families. And God, as we think about those who have served us as veterans, Lord, we are ever so mindful of the Lord Jesus who has served us by giving his life, paying our ransom. And Father, we thank you for those who have followed his example. We thank you for the privilege we have to meet this morning, to worship and to praise a risen and soon coming Savior. Lord, we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together.
Our heart increase, thy mind.
ahead. Let's repeat our memory verse. The ushers just stay, okay? I'm confused. Okay. Okay, let's repeat our memory verse. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. 1 Corinthians 2:9. You may be seated.
Amen. At this time, I would like to invite you down the altar to join me in prayer. And we'll ask the Lord to bless our time as we know He is going to. So please join me here and we'll pray together and then we'll go forward. Heavenly Father, this morning we are grateful that we can bow our heads and get on our knees before You. We want to give You praise today because You are flawlessly faithful. You have provided our every need. You have taken care of our past and our present, and we know You will take care of the future as well. But Lord, as we are here, you have things for us to do. There is ministry that is to be accomplished. And each one of us who calls You as our Savior, You have given us responsibilities. So Lord, I pray that today that we would hear Your call and that not only would we hear, but we would obey. And Lord, as we obey and as we follow Your guiding and Your leading, Father, we know that as a result of our obedience, that as a result of that, many will come to faith in Christ. Lord, we thank You that we can gather, we can sing, we can pray, we can give, we can listen, and we can serve. Lord, I pray for a fresh wind and a fresh fire to fall in this place. Fall fresh upon us. And we ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Servant David, right people of praise. like Jehovah. There's no God 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 like Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation come. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Let's sing together. Father, we do thank you for this day you've given us. And Lord, we give our life to the potter's hand. As we sung those words and express how we feel in those words, Lord, you are the one who molds us and makes us into what you have us to be. Lord, we thank you for a time that we can worship together. And now, Lord, we pray as we present ourselves to you this morning as an offering. Not just the money part, but ourselves to you. We pray, Lord, you use us this day. And we thank you for all you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have your Bibles. I want to ask you to turn with me to the New Testament, to the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter number 5. Very familiar passage, I'm sure. This morning I want to share with you, I would suggest to you that these are some marching orders for us. I'm going to ask you please stand with me as I read to you. Starting in verse number 16. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Let's pray together. Lord, we are grateful this morning for allowing us to assemble together. We are grateful that you have taken care of our greatest need. You have not left us here by ourselves, but you have given us your word, your indwelling spirit. And God, we thank you for all you have done, all you are doing, and all that you will do. Lord, I pray now that as we have read these little short statements in your word directly to us, Lord, help us to once again, afresh and anew, apply these truths to our lives. Lord, I pray for myself that you would cleanse me of my sin, and God, that you would use me today as your spokesman. And God, I ask that you would give the increase. We ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Writing well over 100 years ago, a scholar named James Denny of Scotland called these three commands the standing orders of the gospel. And they're standing orders because they apply to every Christian, everywhere, all the time. And if you look at the original language of it's very clear. These are directives. They're things that we are to do. They're imperatives, but also they're present tense. So you could translate them this way: continually rejoice. Continually. Continually pray. Continually give thanks. All the time. And when you think about those words, when you see them on the screen there, they're very direct. You don't have to really wonder. There's not much really, I guess you would say, dialogue to kind of apply those truths to our lives. But when we look at those words, they're kind of hard to put into practice. Would you not agree? If you were to grade yourself on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you say you're doing on that idea of rejoicing always? Would you say, oh, I'm a 10, I'm always rejoicing? Or would you say I'm a 5? Or would you say I'm less than a 5? But you know what it says there? We're to always be doing this. We're always, always to be rejoicing. Always. And it's very hard to put into practice. Now, it would be easy to put these into practice if they said rejoice sometimes. Amen? Be easy to say, yeah, I can rejoice sometimes. I can do that. Or maybe I can pray occasionally. I can do that. Or maybe this, give thanks when you feel like it. That would be easy, would it not? Doing it during those times. And it's the modifiers of these words, of these statements that kind of trip us up and make it difficult. Always, continually, and in all circumstances. And that's a load, is it not? You kind of apply those truths, and it suggests to me that the real impact of the gospel is this, that even when we don't feel like it, even when we don't want to pray, and we don't want to have a reason to be thankful, we don't think, it's during those times that we discover if our Christian walk, if it is authentic or not. Because it tells us what we are to do. It's very clear, it's crystal in my mind. These simple commands really reveal, I believe, the power of the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. Because of what he has done, we can do these things. We can rejoice, we can pray, and we can give thanks. And it's hard, but it's simple because it's from the inside out. See, what he does for us, he gives us the power and the desire to rejoice. He gives us the power and the desire to pray, the power and the desire to give thanks, even in the most worst moments of life. God's word does that. Now let's look at these statements, kind of break them down if you want to. And as we think about marching orders, notice the first one there. It says that we are to rejoice always. Always rejoice. Now I've got other translations I jotted down here. In the Message paraphrase, it says, be cheerful no matter what. The Holman Christian Standard Bible says, rejoice always. The New Living Bible says, be full of joy all the time. And the Phillips translation says, be happy in your faith at all times. Rejoice always, it says. And when you think about on that first Christmas, when the shepherds heard about the birth of Jesus, what did the shepherd, what the angels call it there? Good news of great what? Joy. Great joy that will be for all people. That includes me. That includes you. That here in our text it says that we are to rejoice always. Now, we sing sometimes at church, we have heard the joyful sound, what? Jesus saves, Jesus saves. We know that song. And whenever the gospel is preached, it is a sweet sound, a joyful sound to everybody that hears that. And when I think about what Jesus has done for me, it's a joyful sound. Amen? When I think of what he's done on my behalf, it is a joyful sound. Tuesday morning, I was reading a devotion that several of us are reading together, and this is what it said. It said that Jesus does what we cannot do for ourselves. Then it made this statement. He literally helps the helpless, for such we all were before Christ. Before Christ, I was helpless. I had zero hope. I was damned. I was doomed. And I was forever separated from God. And what a joyful sound it is, Jesus saves. Amen? That's who I am. Now, the first proof, really, of the gospel's power for many people is what they see in us. And what should they see in us? Well, go back to our text. It says, rejoice when? Sometimes? Always. That's what they're to see in me. And every sermon that is preached, every class that is taught, every beautiful song that is sung, that may lift our spirits, but none of that has the impact of a life that is full of joy all the time. Now, Jesus made this statement. I know you know his words. He says, these things I have spoken to you that my joy may be in you. The joy of Jesus. Now, because the joy of Jesus works from the inside out, let me make some statements. Joy does not depend upon whether or not I have a job or not. That's not where joy comes from. Joy does not depend upon how my friends treat me. Joy does not depend upon my health or the state of my marriage or how my children are doing or who's in the White House or how my favorite team is doing or not doing or how the stock market is doing. That's not where joy comes from. It says rejoice always. Now let's think about what that means as we gather for worship. If we come to worship on a Sunday morning or a Sunday night, or even a Wednesday, and if we come with our problems first and foremost, that's what we are thinking about, that's what we are focused on, and that's easy to do, is it not? We have things going on in our lives, and it's on our minds, it's consuming our thoughts. We come into church, and we're still consumed by those thoughts, those things going on there, and then what we do is we judge worship by how lifted up we feel. And as long as we focus on ourselves and our problems, there will be absolutely no joy in our services. Zero. However, if we come to worship armed with the truth, armed with the facts, the truth of Scripture, thinking about what Jesus has done for me and for you, He's done for us what we have never done for ourselves, and we think how we once were lost, how we were blind, separated from God, we had no hope whatsoever, but God came to us in Jesus. We can rejoice regardless of what we are facing Monday through Saturday. Amen? For what He's done on our behalf. And the joy of Jesus can and it will fill our hearts. Now, it would seem to me that oftentimes that some think they have their spiritual gift is, or the idea that they're, what they're supposed to do is that they have the sacred duty to be gloomy all the time. You ever meet folks like that? Nobody here, I'm sure. They're all out there somewhere else. But, you know, think about that. You know, they're always just doom and gloom. It's always terrible. It's always half full. It's it's terrible. It's just, nothing's going right, never any at all. And I remember, and I was trying to think of the date, and I can't really remember. It's been probably well over 20 years ago. One of the first years I got to go to the Kentucky Baptist Convention, I was excited. I got to go for the first time ever. It was the very first time I went, and I was there, and there was a bunch of people there, and I thought, wow, this is a great big place, and I never will forget what one of the speakers said, and you talk about awkward. It got pretty awkward pretty quick, and I wrote down what he said. He said he was talking to preachers, all right, preachers. And I would say, what I would say, the cream of the crop that can go to those meetings that aren't working all the time, they take off, or so you have the so-called the best of the best, right, supposedly. And this is what he said. We're a bunch of dill-pickle Christians. And I was thinking, all right, that's odd. You know, and I was beginning to look around as he began to expound upon that thought. And he expounded very much in detail. And then he made comments about, well, if I could just get a mirror up here and let you all look at your all's faces, you would agree. Dill pickle and sour and all that kind of stuff. And he said, by the way, look at your facial expressions. And he made this statement. This is where he was going. It would seem to me, he said, that smiling and laughter are sinful to us. And he said, no wonder our churches are plateauing and falling apart. End quote. Wow. Why would somebody want something like a dill pickle relationship with Jesus, where you're always frowning and upset and being out of shape about whatever have you? But the Bible makes it very clear. It says this. It says the joy of the Lord is what? Your strength. The joy of the Lord. Also in Proverbs, I love Proverbs. It says a cheerful heart is good medicine. That's what it says. And Spurgeon made it very plain. He said these words, oh, dear friends, you may rejoice. You may rejoice. God has laid no embargo upon rejoicing. He puts no restriction on happiness. And this is what he said. He said, do believe that you are permitted to be happy. Do believe that there is no ordinance of God commanding you to be miserable. End quote. My friends, we are to rejoice when? Always. We're due. We are not to present a dry, dull, boring faith that has no emotion whatsoever. And what we do is when we do that, we give the impression that if you follow Jesus, you'll become a boring, religious person. And who wants that? I don't. I just wonder in my mind if those who are rejecting the gospel are really just rejecting our poor imitation of it. Because we don't smile. We don't laugh. We're just kind of somber. And one scholar made this suggestion. He said that if the gospel doesn't make your face shine, it may be because you have never tasted it. When I think about where I was and where I am, my goodness, I want to shout. I know where I was headed. I know the life that I was living and where I was going. It was nowhere. But then Jesus came to me. And he tells me in his word here that I am to rejoice always. Not sometimes, not but always. And my friends, that's what we are doing. Now, what my prayer has been this week that my face and your face would shine, that we had a fresh understanding of what Jesus has done on our behalf, and that God would give us eyes to see, and as a result, that we would see those things that we can rejoice over everything somewhere. It's kind of tough when you think about this past week. How can we rejoice over these tragedies that have taken place? Well, we're going to get there in a minute. But the second thing that he tells us we are to do is we're to pray without ceasing. The Phillips translation says this, never stop praying. The Message translation says, it says pray all the time. And of the statements in the text, this one I believe causes, I think, more problems in some ways. What does it mean to pray without ceasing? What does that mean? It means that every thought, every word spoken could be a prayer directed to the Lord. That's what one of the meanings, and in a sense, that's what it means. But when you really think about it and you pause, our entire life ought to be a prayer offered to the Lord. Amen? That's what it says in Scripture, that we are to present ourselves a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service, a reasonable act of worship. So really our entire lives are to be offered to the Lord, and that's certainly a part of the answer, I think, of praying without ceasing. And one scholar compared this phrase, pray without ceasing, to a net that's used to catch fish. When a net functions properly, it lets the water flow through, but it retains the fish. But when there's a hole in the net, the fish go free, they escape. And the same can be true when we pray. There should be no holes in our prayer net. This means we ought to pray often.